So you're in charge of not only whatever business you are running, if you're in financial services or engineering or in community management or whatever it might be, but you're also in charge of running a media business. So this is something that the media companies like TISO, Blackstar, and you know, CliffCentral and the rest of them have been doing for the longest time, but now everybody's in that same business. And thanks to social media and Google and Facebook and all the rest of it, we're now connected in ways that make it very important for people to optimize that media business within their business. And this is something which we're figuring out now at cliffcentral.com. We're trying to find ways, in brief, that have less and less to do with online radio, but more to do with what companies need in order to create the content that matters to their audience, not to an audience, and second of all, to expand that audience and to grow it for themselves, because that point of contact is now direct. You don't need to buy media as you used to in order to reach an audience, because you can cultivate your own. That's how we, I mean, you know, the 3 degrees, Facebook. I know that someone from Facebook will be talking later. Facebook did their own podcast 2 years ago called 3 degrees. Which is about how the old 6 degrees of separation is now 3 degrees of separation. And I think it's even less. It's becoming less and less. You can reach anyone you like now by finding them on social media and messaging them. Chances of them replying are probably quite high if you have a really good reason for contacting them. That was impossible before. That level of connection is just extraordinary. So podcasting, to put it into context, should be a part of everyone's media mix, because it is the fastest growing medium in America at the moment. Medium in America. It's outpacing social media. It's growing at 70% year on year, and this is for the last 3 years. Nielsen figures have shown that, and Edison Research. They're gathering momentum in South Africa too, and there are a lot of businesses, Investec is one that deserves credit too, who are hopping on board the podcasting train now. The reasons that podcasting works, the reason that it appeals to people, is because we're not stupid. We're not vapid, and we don't only like 280 characters. We actually want some depth. We want some meaning. We want some narrative. We want some complication. We want stuff that can fire off many different things, and not just the kind of outrage you'd get on Twitter, or having to look at someone's baby photos on Facebook, or any of the puerile stuff that you're finding in traditional media to a large degree, which is mostly lowest hanging fruit so they can get the biggest audiences. What happens to those audiences who want really valuable content? The audience who are looking for the most info at the most granular level of detail. Those people are not being served anymore, and podcasting is a great way to reach them. So, we know about all these trends that are changing in our industry. The internet has unleashed the ability for everyone to communicate directly with their customers, and you're now a broadcaster. So, what does this mean? It means that the brand owns the media. It's an asset now. Young people today have grown up with the internet, and that means that if you are not online and you're not on these devices, for a lot of these young people, you don't exist. And if you're imagining that doing things the same old way, which is what a lot of ad agencies and media businesses have been doing for the longest time, if you think you can keep doing that, you are very quickly running out of time, and you're also, your audience is getting older and dying rather than growing and becoming the nascent next, you know, boom generation who are buying, selling, taking an interest, creating, co-creating very often. So at Cliff Central, we've learned a few things. First of all, the power of content is something you need to know about. Brands need to make their own content, but it needs to be entertaining, inspiring, informative, or empowering. Those are the four categories that we list for content. And if it isn't one of those things, or it isn't more than one of those things, you're probably not doing the right kind of content. Tim said something interesting, which I'd like to pick up on too. You see how much I'm plagiarizing from you, because it was so good. He said that you don't always have to talk about what your core competence is. You can create content around stuff that people in your business and your clients and your partners overseas and your suppliers in South Africa are interested in. And you can create a community around that, which can bolster your business and do wonders for the ROI stuff and for sales, but also to just create that closeness, the kind of engagement that people throw around as a word. They don't really know what it means, but engagement really is when you and I are having a conversation and we go, oh my God, I think that too, or wasn't that interesting, or laugh together at something, or smile, or cry. These are the things that engage people. So the power of content is something that's become fairly obvious to us, and the way that you deploy that is the next thing, because it's the power of the virtual auditorium. This is a crowd of, what, 60 people or so? Now, this is a podcast, effectively. If we turn it into a podcast, which I'm sure you'll be doing after this, Tim, it is now available to a much bigger audience forever. And they don't have to be here and struggle with the parking that you were telling us we have to get this ticket for, or drink your lovely coffee, or take up your space when you could be doing other things. But the fact is, this is valuable to an audience that aren't physically present. And everyone here is valuable for me, because you're listening to me, but you're also valuable to Jellyfish and to all the various businesses that you're here to represent. This is an important gathering. It should reach more people. Podcasting makes that possible. If it's the kind of content that's interesting to you, chances are it'll be interesting to someone else. So if we can fill a room like this, and you can virtually fill an auditorium of 1,000 people, that's incredible. If 1,000 people come week after week for a podcast, that's like having that discovery summit that they have once a year, where they have to bring out Bill and Hillary Clinton. That's like having that every week. Now that's tremendous. That's a different way of looking at it. It's not a media buy. This is about content creation and reaching that virtual auditorium of people. You could also get into their heads for a long time when you do that. I mean, if you're able to command someone's attention, and some podcasts are 3-4 hours long. I've listened to podcasts that are 8 hours long, not in one go, but over a period of a few days. Just imagine what a marketer or an advertiser will pay to be in someone's head for 4 hours. That is unheard of. That's the gold of marketing that we've only now found a way, thanks to this technology and the scalability of it, to be able to reach. The final thing, the power of content, power of virtual auditorium, the final thing is the power of the tribe building itself. Again, Tim showed a slide of Seth Godin, whose book Tribes I read within the first 3 months of us starting Cliff Central, and it occurred to me, we're starting a tribe. And, you know, in this country and in parts of the world where there are tensions around this, tribalism tends to have a bad reputation. But in this case, it's a virtual tribe. And I'll give you a quick example of one of the things we're doing at the moment that illustrates this point very well. We're doing a podcast series for Waterfall Estate, that estate in Midrand. They've got about 9 residential developments in there, the Mall of Africa. They've got a hospital. They've got schools. It's a community by all definitions. And now we're helping them to turn that real community into a digital community, which feeds back into the real community. They're doing a once-a-month podcast, which lets people in on what's going on in the estate, who developed it, what the history of the estate is, what you can do there that you didn't know about, security stuff, upgrades, interesting information. It'll take people 15 minutes to listen to it on the way into work once a month, and they won't have to read some newsletter, which they don't anyway. They won't have to partake in some community meeting. God knows who goes to those. ANC branch members, I can't imagine who else. And we've created a virtual community for them where there's a real community, and that in turn becomes the real community again. This is actually happening right now, and it's very innovative because this hasn't been done before. I think this could probably be a blueprint for all the other estates around the country, and there are a lot of them, trust me, and for complexes, and for, you can get down to that level of detail. And the people presenting it are the people who live there, the people who work there, the people who commute to and from, the people who own the helipad that's the only commercial helipad in South Africa, or in Gauteng, I think, that you can charter into the middle of Joburg to go where you're going to. These are things that people don't know unless they find it from podcasts. And remember, this podcast is not available to all of you unless you live there. So I'm not looking at an audience and trying to find them 10,000 listeners or clicks or interactions or engagements. If 20 people in the estate start listening to it and they tell 20 people in the estate to start listening to it, eventually you have an organic, viral multiplication of this in a way that's very natural, that doesn't require hard marketing or hard messaging or any of the stuff that advertisers used to promise. And it's serving that community in a way that other things could not. Why? Because when you listen to something, it's not incurring on your other time. You know what I mean? People have very little time. If you listen to something while you're driving, it's not taking up more of your time. You don't have the budget for it like you do for a book or for a lecture or for something else that improves your brain. This is very important. So what's a podcast listener worth? Well, this is something that we've been trying to figure out, and we've actually called in some real experts, an actuary and a behavioral scientist who's been hosting a show on our platform for a long time. The premise is this. We call it the voluntary influencer impact theory. All right. The premise is that in the podcast community, a single subscriber is not measured just as an individual. We call them podfluencers at cliffcentral.com. They have to be weighed in an audience ecosystem within themselves. An individual carries multiple levels of associated brand growth. And remember, these people are actual ambassadors in a real way for what that content is. Gives you social cachet, too. How many of you have not had someone say to you, you have to listen to this podcast? And then when you have, you've been happy you did. It's either given you an insight into the economy that you didn't have before, or it's given you something to laugh about, or it's given you something to be inspired about where there's mostly bad news. And if you go onto social media, there's a lot of bad news. So this is where you find the leading edge of human thinking, of ideas, of inspiration. And that, I think, is very powerful. So there's this co-creator influence that this community have, which is another powerful influence that they can exert. A committed subscriber co-opts podcast content and creates an additional stream of content built on leveraging the podcast, which gets published onto their social media platforms and blogs. And again, Google, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, for me, these are vehicles for distribution. I don't want them to be the ones who provide me with the content. I'd rather get that from a trusted friend. And podcasts are often the kind of thing that you get from someone you trust and someone you respect. If someone you don't trust and respect says to you, listen to this podcast, you probably think, no, they're a douchebag. Why should I listen to them? Tribal listening. When a committed subscriber shares the podcast with their community, the individual receives the podcast within the stream of behavioral chemical bonding. This is a thing that that Richard Thaler and what's the other guy's name? What's his name? Daniel Kahneman from Thinking Fast and Slow talk about. They talk about how when you own the content on your own device and you share it with someone, it creates this connection between the two of you. And it means that that is invested with a value that is more than if you just discovered it lying around. You know, your car looks like a lot of other cars on the road, but because it's yours, you feel very connected to your car. And associative impact is the last one. This has to do with the brain operating on that thinking fast and slow dynamic where it's an efficiency machine. And when someone shares a podcast, the receiving brain receives it with what is termed one, the one kind of thinking, or the fast, low effort side of the brain, as opposed to that number two, much more complicated, reasoned, thought through part of the brain. This is stuff that Timothy Webster, Timothy Maurice Webster, has been working with us on. He's been studying this stuff at MIT, among other things. And this is his area of expertise. It has to do with the way we absorb content and what appeals to us and why. So your question is probably, why are podcasts exploding? And the answer is simply because they provide a way for people to be inspired, to entertain themselves, to learn. And learning is important. I think that ultimately universities will become podcast creators, and that's all they'll do. There won't be a campus. There won't be fees for that stuff. You won't have to feed people and put them in a hostel and have to worry about whether or not they are in danger from other students. They will learn by listening to podcasts. And remember, with a podcast, the people who are coming to listen to that are opting in. These are not people who are passing by and happen to listen to it like radio. Podcasting, if they've come to it, they've downloaded it, and they've pressed play, you have a very good chance of them listening all the way through. So it's exploding because they endow this network of friends and associates with the same content they've found and that has improved their lives. And that emotional attachment is the endowment effect. It's got a name already, and this is Thaler's thing. He's, of course, the Nobel Prize-winning economist and the professor of behavioral science and economics at the University of Chicago's Booth School of Business, if you want to check his bona fides. So, Tim already referred to this, but it's something I wrote down a week and a half ago, and while he was talking, I thought probably a good idea to bring it up. For the last few years, we've been told we're in an attention economy, right? We are. But it isn't for less and less, these bite-sized things, more and more of that information being forced onto us. It's for more and more in terms of quality and depth and value. And from that point of view, what I mean is marketers, pundits, speakers, writers, creatives, businesses want to make a difference. They don't just want to get your attention. If you talk to young people now, it's not enough for them to just earn a salary, to just be in an organization and clock in the morning and clock out. This industrial revolution way of thinking has given way to something which has massive depth, meaning, value, purpose. And I think the bandwidth and format of new platforms like podcasts, but especially YouTube too, make it possible for big ideas to enter the conversation, for complicated debates to take place, and for these interactions between individuals to take place in a way that was never possible before. And for brands that used to try to sell to start meaning things. Brands have all taken on. I mean, during the media revolution of the early 2000s, people were talking about their own brand. You know, you'd meet someone in the street and they'd say, I'm trying to grow my brand. And you'd think, well, you've got five followers on Instagram. What brand is this? But the fact is that big brands at that stage were only shouting louder and louder and spending more and more money just to be top of mind. And Lisa referred to this too. We're in a battle for attention. That's how it was. But they didn't really tell us who they were, these brands. Now we're seeing all the big global brands shifting their focus to meaning, to purpose, to sustainability, and to values in a way that I don't think Gordon Gekko in the 80s would have understood. Big brands want to be experienced. They don't just want to sell you things or buy things from you. They want to be experienced like people, with character, with nuance, with subtlety, with empathy, not as factories that just churn out product. So advertising hasn't died. Of course, it's changed. But it's changed into something that we're much more comfortable with because it feels integrated. We want to take it into our lives now because it's content we care about. And conversely, it has to be said, that we shut these things out a lot more easily now if it offends or it disappoints or it shouts at us. So hard marketing and advertising is now a turn off and will probably do your business more damage than good. And I think born again out by the example of what Investec are doing. They're not saying to you, we are the best bank, we can grow your wealth portfolio. That kind of messaging is going to have exactly the adverse effect. So what they're doing is creating interesting stuff that makes them a media business within the bank, within the wealth business, within the investment business, that connects people to it so it becomes part of their lives. This is just part of what people do. And they're getting useful stuff out of this that they want to share with other people. It's tremendously powerful. So, thanks to platforms like podcasting, YouTube, social media, it's much easier for people to spot a fake and to make a friend. And that goes for soft drinks as much as it does for people now. So you're in the business of creating content, and that's very exciting. I don't want to talk too much more. I want to take questions, if you don't mind. I've already spoken for too long. We've got about 10-12 minutes, so we can go with some questions. Go ahead. What's that? Oh, the case study. This is a minute, so it won't take up too much more time. This is an example of a podcast series we've done with Taylor Blinds and Shutters. It's unconventional. They're a window dressing company. Here's what we've done with them. Take a look at this.
Just started talking about history. I remember talking about Marcus Aurelius and the Danube in the winter. The idea was born then about doing a history podcast. And I think from the creative side, Gareth, he felt it could work because I had no clue. I wasn't sure how it would pan out.
You know, when two people, and I assume because of the success of the series, it's more than two people, are as interested in a subject as this, then that's a conversation. And since podcasting is all about authentic conversations, and about delivering really entertaining, informative, inspiring, empowering stuff to an audience, this was an obvious one. And I'm just glad that it worked out the way that it did, because it took an enormous amount of trust from both sides to do something that had never really been done.
Minutes after he entered the room, they murdered him.
Most famous murder in history.
could do this in the form of a lecture series. We could do this in the form of, you know, dramatic, semi-fictional stuff. I mean, there's plenty of places you could take this.
I'd be very happy if you could play a small part in making history exciting.
So the idea here, in short, is that we've helped them to create stuff that an audience that might not even be buying blinds or shutters at the moment might be interested in, but it'll put them at the top of their minds when those people do need to buy that stuff. It's that simple. And for them, it's worked out as a trip. We're doing season two at the moment. They're 15 minutes each. If you want to subscribe, I think you might like them. Tell your friends. Change shouldn't be frightening. If any of you are sitting there going, oh my God, the business I'm in is falling apart, revenues are down, advertising's dead, it's horrible, it's not really. Do yourself a favor. Here's my for free tip to make your day better. Go to a website called humanprogress.org today. It's run by a friend of mine called Marion Tupi. It will tell you about all the things that you don't see in the headlines that are going on that are wonderful, that make humanity right now the best kind of humanity to be a part of. And you read one of those stories before you start your day, you will feel better about everything from there on in. If you read traditional media and you go on Twitter, you're gonna feel worse about everything. It's like eating absolute shit before you start your day or having a good, well-balanced meal. Thank you very much.